Welcome to Speak for Yourself. I'm Jason Whitlock. That's Marcellus Wiley. That dude.
Brother.
Coming up, I'll tell you why Patrick Mahomes might not be the hottest quarterback in his own division.
And I'll tell you the real reason why the Steelers lost to the Broncos yesterday. But we start every day with a Whitlock. What you got today to go?
Aaron Rodgers can't save the Packers. Not this time. In 2014, after a 1-2 start, Rodgers told Packers fans to relax. They finished the season 12-4 and lost in overtime in the NFC Championship. In 2016, after a 4-6 start, Rodgers predicted the Packers would run the table. They did, and lost to the Falcons in the NFC Championship. After last night's 24-17 loss to Minnesota, the Packers are 4-6-1, but Rodgers sounds somewhat confident they can win their remaining 5 games and sneak into the postseason.
So we just got to go back home, get some rest, beat Arizona, and then come back and beat Atlanta and go to Chicago, a place we've won a number of times, beat them, go to New York around Christmas, beat them, and come home against Detroit, beat them, get a little help.
Sounds doable, doesn't it? Cardinals, Falcons, Jets, and Lions. There's only 13 victories among those 4 teams. And hey, the Packers have already beaten the 8-3 Bears this season. Here's the problem with Rodgers saving the Packers. He has to save himself first. He's part of the problem. Firing head coach Mike McCarthy midseason won't fix anything. Aaron Rodgers isn't right mentally or physically. He's missing throws. He ranks 28th in the league in completion percentage. He's also no longer a real threat with his legs. He hasn't had a rushing touchdown since Christmas Eve 2016. Hate to go here, but let's be honest. The drama within his family has to be a distraction too. During Thanksgiving week, his brother Jordan took a devastating public shot at him when he called Aaron out for not checking on his mother during the California fires. Jordan called his brother a phony and legitimized all the rumors about Aaron's aloof and weird personality. Aaron Rodgers isn't a leader. He's an amazing talent. He's Wilt Chamberlain. You marvel at their gifts, but you wonder if those same gifts undermine their greatness. All that talent can make you socially awkward. It can convince you that other people aren't instrumental in your overall success. Who would you rather be, Superman or Batman? Clark Kent has it all. He has every superpower. He's a one-man army. But he's not that interesting or compelling. Beating Superman is relatively easy. Just find some kryptonite, and Superman is just a nerdy dude who writes for the local newspaper. Now, Bruce Wayne, he's an international playboy, the billionaire owner of Wayne Enterprises. Bruce Wayne is a leader of men. He protects Gotham City with the help of Alfred the Butler, Police Commissioner Gordon, Robin, Catwoman. There's no simple solution to beating Batman. Aaron Rodgers is just as much of the Packers' problems this year as Mike McCarthy. All right, joining the desk now are Hall of Famer Rod Woodson, future Hall of Famer Tony Gonzalez. Marcellus, I'll start with you.
Ran out of Hall of Famers.
I did.
Not over yet.
Columbia Hall of Fame.
Hall of Fame.
Columbia doesn't count.
Columbia Hall of Fame. Start with you, Marcellus. Yeah. Aaron Rodgers, as much a part of the problem as Mike McCarthy.
He is, and I didn't want to come to that conclusion, but listening to you watching that game last night, when you're watching Aaron Rodgers become a part of the problem, for too long, Aaron Rodgers was sitting aside, separate from all the confusion and turmoil, and it was almost this NBA mentality to the Green Bay Packers where you got a guy who goes out there, who's the star, and it seemed like everyone else on the Packers is just watching that star make all the plays. I mean, you can watch it right now when you see LeBron James out there, everyone, or Kobe Bryant of yesterday, of everyone just sitting around dancing. It's like, oh, what's he going to do? And then we could feed off of that. Now, he's not making those same plays in those same moments that lives up to his name and reputation of being Aaron Rodgers the Great. He's a part of the issue. I'm looking at this team, and Aaron Rodgers has to look and say, I have to be the star player that can help us overcome our adversities, overcome our obstacles. And there was a day where Aaron Rodgers was doing that consistently. Now he's kind of converted. I don't want to throw interceptions, 20 touchdowns, 1 interception. So I'm going to throw incompletions. He's throwing a lot of incompletions. His completion percentage, 28th in the league. in part because this offense lacks consistency. So I'm watching a guy start to become a part of the pack. And when he becomes a part of this pack, because of the lack of firepower they have, the result is what we saw last night.
You know, first of all, Jordan, his brother, shouldn't air family grievances publicly.
Going there?
That's the first thing. All right.
If they're family.
Secondly, when you look at it, first of all, the leaders start with the head coach. Think about all the great teams in this league right now. All right, you got Mike Tomlin, Bill Belichick, McVay, Sean Payton, Andy Reid. They start. It starts there. The quarterback is a part of that. Yes, is he playing the way we've known Aaron Rodgers to play in the past? No. He has no running game. They're 20th in rushing. His defense doesn't make plays. If they do score, it's a 12, 10-play, 8-play drive down the field. He has to make all the plays. If he doesn't throw for three touchdowns, four touchdowns, 350 yards, they lose. Mm-hmm. That's unfair. That's unfair to any player. Now, what I do say is that we know that he hasn't played the way we normally see Aaron Rodgers play. He's missed some throws. The last couple, remember the fourth or the third and two, or the fourth and one, he threw the ball in the dirt. Well, that's not normally happening. Yesterday, he threw a second one. He was in the dirt. Then he misses Adams in the end zone.
Yeah.
That's normally not Aaron Rodgers-esque. You know, is he the leader of that football team? He doesn't have to be the leader of that football team in a sense that all quarterbacks aren't the leaders of the football team. Just because you're the great player doesn't mean you're the outspoken vocal player to galvanize your football team. And it has to start with the head coach. I give more blame to Mike McCarthy because this system is the same system we've seen from day one. It hasn't changed at all. And you have to understand, Andy Reid has started this thing way back in the day in Philly. It's not the same offense he had in Philly. It's a different offense because it's a different year. So he has to come up with the times to help Aaron Rodgers out to win football games. And he has to get more players around him to help win football games. It can't be all put on his shoulders week in and week out, year after year after year. That's unfair.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I think right now, yeah, he's part of the problem. I think psychologically he's been messed up since the beginning of the year. I remember before earlier in the year he was saying that I don't have the type of players that I need to go out there and make plays. And I think that's easy to say. Devontae Adams, and then who else is there? Really, like a big-time football player on that offense. But he's still able to put up pretty decent numbers. Yeah, he's not playing like he used to. But if anybody's going to turn this around, he does it all. You went through the whole thing, R-E-L-A-X. We're going to run them all off. He just basically called his shot again. That's what I take that as. If anybody's going to turn this around, it's this man. I'd never go against this guy, and I won't until he doesn't able to deliver on what he says. Why would I go against what he's said before, and he's always come through with it? I would not be surprised. Are you going to be surprised when they rattle off five in a row, if they do?
It's not going to happen.
Okay, we'll see.
Because what I believe is kryptonite has happened. And what kryptonite for Aaron Rodgers is, last year was the clavicle injury. This year it's the knee injury. The wear and tear on him, I think, is a ongoing problem moving forward for Aaron Rodgers. When I look at him miss Devontae Adams, he just can't do what he used to be able to do. He could throw off his back foot. All of his mechanics could be wrong, and he could still deliver the ball right where it's supposed to be. I just don't think he can do that anymore. I think the wear and tear on his body is starting to catch up with him. Last year, he couldn't overcome them and their bad start. They fell short of the playoffs. It's going to happen again this year.
I'm with Tony on that one. Like, I'm not betting against this guy, even though there's no evidence this year that this team can rally five straight victories. But backs against the wall, with Aaron Rodgers being that talented at that position that has so much control and dictates terms for a football squad, you got to bet with this team. You got to bet that this team can try and figure this out in this moment because they do. Look, they can't run the ball and they can't stop the run. And that's really undermining what they do.
Their offense was the problem last night, not their defense.
No, it wasn't. But creatively, they're not striking fear. Rodney Harrison made that point. Dungy went where you went, Rod, talking about the organization. Why aren't you stockpiling this team offensively, especially at the receiver position, when you have Aaron Rodgers, the great, as a talent at quarterback?
I'm going to go back to leadership again and in terms of rallying this team. I think Aaron Rodgers made it crystal clear he doesn't like Mike McCarthy. He's out on Mike McCarthy. And he's made that clear. If we can feel it here in Los Angeles, they damn sure can feel it in Green Bay. So I just don't think there's a foundation for them to rally around, because you got your quarterback, your most talented player, the guy that's rescued you. He's not on board with the head coach. That's chaos. That's a recipe for a team to mail it in the rest of the season. They're not. Look, it won't just be the Bears that get them, because the Bears are a good team. One of these other Jets, Cardinals, Falcons, somebody else is going to get them. They're not making the playoffs.
You might be right about that. They're inconsistent as a team, not just Aaron Rodgers. I mean, let's get that straight. Their defense doesn't get the turnovers the way they need. They got a lot of young guys in the back end, but they chose to have these young guys in the back end.
Yeah.
They chose to have this type of team. It is the general managers and the front office personnel opportunity or job is to give the coaching staff some weapons to have on the football field. And it's the coaching's job to put the best players on the field and look at the system itself and say, you know what? They didn't like Dom Capers, or the defense coordinator. They say, we needed some new blood, new fresh look at it. And they bring in Pettin. And they haven't played terrible, but they haven't played great. But Mike McCarthy is the OC, basically, for this football team. He hasn't changed the system since they've been there. It's static. It's 2x2. They run some jet sweep. It's very predictable. And then you put all that pressure on that one quarterback, and you're telling that player, that individual player, out the multiple. This is the ultimate team sport. That he has to be the one.
He's wanted to be that guy. He's been that guy. I'm gonna go back to leadership.
Everybody wants that. Everybody wants it on their shoulders, but they need help.
I'm gonna go back to leadership and the difference between him and Tom Brady. Tom Brady had a little bit of a fight with Bill Belichick this offseason and early on this season. But Tom Brady also has Gronkowski and that whole team, that whole locker room behind
him. But the leadership starts with Bill Belichick.
I get it. But Brady and Belichick were at odds. The whole locker room, the players are with Tom Brady, and it has worked out. I just don't think guys in that locker room follow Aaron Rodgers. And Aaron Rodgers' brother was wrong for airing out the dirty laundry. But it keeps happening to Aaron Rodgers. You got teammates that air him out and talk about him personally. His brother does it. And you know, last week, I think, to some degree, we talked about it as a money thing. And really, I think if you go do the research, it was more about his ex-girlfriend, Olivia Munn, and her clashing with the family. That's what drove a lot of that. I'm just saying, there's a quirk in Aaron Rodgers' personality that makes him different and not the same kind of leader some of the other great quarterbacks.
You've been reading your Us Weekly, huh?
Right before checkout. Put the Snickers down and get the Us Weekly. Whitlock in there.
You know, my only knock against Aaron Rodgers ever, and I say this is, and you guys can agree with me or not, this is just my personal knock. It's about him taking $33 million. When your guys go down, Randall Cobb goes down, Geronimo goes down, then you don't have those backup players. I mean, some of those receivers out there, I'm like, who is that guy? I never even heard of that guy.
Right, right.
And he's throwing them open sometime. And so I think that messes with your confidence a little bit. I like Aaron, but also, too, it's what's been brought up about him before. Can he evolve with that offense? We talk about Mike McCarthy. I bet Mike McCarthy also would say, if he could talk to us, too, and say, well, you know what? Aaron likes to throw the ball deep. He likes to make those big splash plays where Tom Brady will throw the ball 5 yards, 6 yards, all the way down, doing whatever it takes to win, where Aaron wants to throw over the top and throw for big plays. You don't have those type of players anymore. You have to change this offense. They need to get those guys in positions to be successful, which is why the Belichicks are such good coaches, because they coach that.
And Mike McCarthy might have the opportunity to talk to us after this.
Oh, he's
year
coming.
Too,
so. Hugh Jackson style.
He might have that opportunity.
We keep beating up on Mike McCarthy, and he's going to get fired. But a guy has to want to be coached as well.
No. Let's talk about that leadership. Be real about Aaron Rodgers. Look, if I were on that team, doesn't seem like the best leader for my style of play. Look, there are a lot of ways to lead, and Aaron Rodgers has a leadership issue in this respect. He could borrow something from Russell Wilson in terms of how Russell Wilson sounds scripted. Sounds like he's going out there and just thanking everyone for no apparent reason, but it does engage others to feel like they're a part of this group project. Aaron Rodgers, for many a times at the podium and just in his personal relationships with his teammates, doesn't empower them, so therefore it becomes this wait and let me go do this. If I don't do this, it doesn't happen. I know a lot of questions in that locker room, and I know one that is not the problem. Ty Montgomery was a scapegoat because you came on this show and everybody told me, oh, Ty Montgomery, get him out of town and then things are going to be fixed. No. This team hasn't won a game on the road, man. Bigger issues than just the player dynamic. It really starts at the top. And in this program, $67 million this year is Aaron Rodgers' payroll. Guess what? It starts with Aaron Rodgers and his lack of leadership.
All right, welcome back to the show. Time for some big stories. Whitlock and Wiley, Rod Woodson and Tony Gonzalez are here. Let's return to the NFL, where the Broncos beat the Steelers 24-17, snapping Pittsburgh's six-game win streak. Big Ben threw 56 times for over 450 yards, but his last-minute interception on third and goal sunk the Steelers. Still, Roethlisberger didn't seem too concerned about the pick after the game.
I never would have thought in a million years that a defensive lineman would get blocked off the ball that far right into an interception, but good play by him. He's not dropping. He got blocked right into the play, so there's no way to ever think that guy's going to make that play. And of all the interceptions I've thrown, that's one of the most fluky I've ever been associated with.
All right, it doesn't seem fluky that the Steelers' offense has struggled since Le'Veon Bell officially decided to skip the season. They're averaging less than 20 points per game and haven't rushed for over 100 yards since November 4th. All right, look, Big Ben's going to take some heat for that interception. He's making crazy excuses because if the defensive tackle hadn't intercepted it, there was a defensive back in prime position.
Roby was right there.
Right there. But I don't blame Big Ben. I blame the Steelers organization and the coaching staff to some degree, but mostly the organization. If they had Le'Veon Bell on this roster, they wouldn't have thrown the ball 56 times in a one-possession football game. Le'Veon Bell would have dictated the money they would have had invested in him and just the talent. We would be playing. If they had Le'Veon, they would be the AFC version of the New Orleans Saints. They would have Le'Veon Bell and James Conner, and they'd be running the football in a more balanced offense. They'd be protecting their older quarterback the same way the Saints have. They would be the Saints of the AFC. But because they didn't want to make the commitment to Le'Veon Bell, they come out with a foolish game plan. I think they threw the ball 10 or 12 straight times to start the game. Put way too much on Ben's back. Offense out of balance. This is on the organization for not investing in Le'Veon Bell.
How long have you been waiting to say that?
I really haven't.
Boy, I haven't been in the media forever, but I do know one thing. As soon as Le'Veon Bell was not on the Steelers roster, I just started my clock. I was like, time. Someone is going to wait to insert the moment where you see anything wrong with this offense. All Le'Veon Bell's the fix. But Le'Veon Bell has been there for many years, and the offense has had this roller coaster ride. I understand you're saying that's too many times in terms of pass attempts, but that wasn't an indictment on James Conner. Look, this was a 20th ranked rush offense last year with Le'Veon, and it's a 27th ranked offense in terms of rush this year without Le'Veon. So not huge difference, but yeah, you're better with Le'Veon Bell. I've been saying that since day one. The thing that beat the Pittsburgh Steelers weren't the Denver Broncos. They didn't wear orange. It was themselves. They beat themselves by having two turnovers, including one pass reception at the goal line. Think about it. The most important statistic in terms of win-loss is the turnover ratio, right? You can't lose that battle, and they lost that battle. And then they gave up 14 points in those moments of those same turnovers. One on the goal line. Hey, bro, just make a move inside and score instead of trying to run through a guy. Second one is a pick we just showing from Ben Roethlisberger. My point is you can't lose a turnover battle and give up 14 points and expect to win the game. That's why they lost.
You know, you look at this football team, and four turnovers on the road, you'll never win a football game like that. It's very rare that a team can go on the road, turn the ball over four times, and win that game. And that, you know, the same thing that you love about Ben is what you hate about Ben. Because Ben will hold on to the ball, guy will be draped all over him, and he'll throw the ball for a touchdown. He's taking those shots down the field. And Randy Fichtner, the offensive coordinator in his first year doing so, he has to make sure this team going throughout the rest of this year is a balanced attack. Now, Connor gave up. He dropped that ball twice. He put it on the ground twice this past game. He has to make sure in a simple screenplay where he's like, he could have just ran vertical and got almost close to the goal line. When a guy hits you in the knees, you can't fumble the football. He didn't even touch the ball. He just like popped the ball out. Yeah. You got to make sure you protect the football. This is a good football team. At the end of the day, I remember being on the show at the beginning of the year. They were bickering in the locker room, and I'm saying they're going to be fine.
Yeah.
This team is still going to be fine. This is a good football team. You just can't turn the ball over when you go on the road and think you're going to win. In the National Football League, you just know that. And, Tony, you're an offensive player more than anything. You know, what did your coach say? Take care of that football when it's your opportunity. When you turn the ball over on the road, you're not going to get victory.
Yeah, absolutely kills you. But looking at the question, did the Steelers miss Le'Veon Bell? Yeah, they missed him even earlier in the season. I don't care what anybody says. This guy is a good football player, man, and they should have paid him. Connor, I think that's psychological now. Le'Veon's not coming back. There's no more threat of that. So now I got it. I don't know. I'm just looking because he has not played that well. And the only reason he hasn't, unless he's hurt or something, there's something going on in his brain. I remember my first year, I didn't start, and I played pretty well. That second year as a full-time starter, I dropped 17 balls. When we don't even go there, would you? But he was the reporter back then. Killing me in the media. But it was something like a psychological shift now, knowing that I am the guy and that I'm the full-time starter. And I think maybe that's what's going on with Connor. But Le'Veon Bell, for sure they miss him. They would be a lot better football team if they had him on this team.
If they didn't have six titles, if they hadn't won all those titles, they would have Le'Veon Bell. But the Steelers approach everything like, hey, we're the Steelers. We've won six Super Bowls. You know, if we win one this year, great. If they were a desperate organization, they would have Le'Veon Bell there, and they would be a much better team. And I'll say it again, they would be the Saints of the AFC, virtually unstoppable.
They will be a different team because it would have a two-headed monster in the backfield. And Le'Veon's a different running back. I mean, you always want your best players. He's like shown all the other running backs in the league we see that hesitate nowadays and then wait for the blockers and the hold to unfold and they take off. He's the reason because of that, because he's a patient running back. But overall, the Steelers, they do it their way. That is true. They gave him the franchise tag. He chose not to sign that franchise tag. He wanted a long-term deal. That's not what has to happen. If players don't like that, they have to change the CBA. So you have to go back there. You can't blame the team for using the mechanism that they allowed to be there.
I got it. But as an organization, trust me, if this was the Cowboys and they felt like they were this close and maybe I got to give Le'Veon a bad contract in order to get this next Super Bowl, they're going to give Le'Veon that bad contract. The Steelers refused to do it, unlike the overwhelming majority of organizations would be a bit more desperate. Steelers like the Patriots. They try to do more with less. Other teams would try to do more with more.
It's just interesting that, one of the things you spoke of is that if Le'Veon was there, they wouldn't throw the ball this much. But then you look at Ben Roethlisberger's reference in his numbers. Not only this year did they throw the ball more times, he had a 60-attempt game, but also last year with Le'Veon there, 66 attempts in a winning effort against Baltimore. There's times when, whether you have game plan, whether there are circumstances changing that game plan, there are times where I've seen this Steelers offense get off script and get off balance and turn it into just a throwing fest. And against a team on the road, and I just saw that same team, the Denver Broncos, come to L.A., beat a red-hot Chargers team, playing with a lot of fire for a team under 500. Then they get a team that's giving them gifts, two gifts in the end zone, four in total. You're going to get beat. I don't care who you're playing against in the NFL. You give up that turnover ratio.
They started the game with no regard for the running game.
Yeah.
I'm just that would never happen if Le'Veon – if they're paying Le'Veon Bell what it would have took to have Le'Veon Bell, you just don't have that game plan. We're paying this guy too much money to just put it all on Ben. All right, welcome back. Whitlock and Wiley, Rod Woodson and Tony Gonzalez are here. Let's return to the NFL, where Phillip Rivers tied an NFL record with 25 straight completions in the Chargers' dominating win over the Cardinals. Rivers is quietly having an MVP season, ranking in the top five in touchdowns and passer rating. Tony was on the Fox NFL Sunday yesterday and had an interesting Rivers comparison.
You guys remember the movie Toy Story? If Patrick Mahomes is Buzz Lightyear, then Phillip Rivers is Woody. Because look at him, he's still got it. What's so funny? Woody.
Funny.
You guys see Woody, right?
No.
Woody
Buzz Lightyear. You're just too smart for me. No, that's good.
I haven't seen Toy Story, but I do like the Patrick Mahomes, Phillip Rivers conversation. And the question, it's not about who's down the road, I think everybody's clear, Patrick Mahomes is the next great quarterback. But the rest of this season, who would you rather have, Patrick Mahomes or Phillip Rivers? One guy's got 10 interceptions, the other guy's got 6 interceptions, one guy's got 15 years in the league, the other guy's this first year starting. I'm going with the veteran, Phillip Rivers. For the rest of this season, I'd rather have Phillip Rivers.
No, you don't. No, you wouldn't. This is an amazing mental dynamic and mental gymnastics we're playing right here. Best indicator of future behavior is past behavior. Who's winning the MVP conversation between these two?
Patrick Mahomes.
Patrick Mahomes, right?
Those
so if you show me a greater body of work this year in a vacuum, then why wouldn't I expect for you to be the guy that can continue that same body of work, even though both are playing at an amazing level? I'm not picking number two in the conversation just because he's older. I was at the game yesterday.
More experienced.
You're walking right into these traps. Yeah. I'm at the game yesterday. And for every praise you hear of Phillip Rivers, you hear the same fan that is weary about how this is going to end. Every fan that loves Phillip Rivers kept coming up to me saying, well, how are they going to perform in the playoffs? Is Phillip Rivers clutch? Will we ever get over this hump? So even though you have 15 years of experience, you still haven't checked that box in terms of experience parlaying into actual championship or actual true contention. They went to the AFC Championship 1 year. He didn't have any knees. LT didn't have his knees either. That was their only opportunity. My point is, if I don't have a guy who has proven in the playoffs that he's that guy, then I'm going to go with the young gun who's just outplaying the old guy. So to me, it's a simple solution. You go with the one who's been doing it all year.
All right, question.
Yeah.
What system we playing in?
Ooh.
Who offensive system we playing in?
We playing in the one they're playing in now.
Which he's, one?
With the Chargers.
Chargers or Chiefs?
The Chargers or Chiefs.
Chargers or Chiefs system.
We're playing in the Chargers. Okay. Phillip Rivers is playing in this Chargers system.
Okay. You want to go there, okay?
Yeah.
He didn't want to play with my game, okay?
Who you want the rest of this season?
You know what? I would like to have Phillip Rivers for the regular season, Patrick Mahomes for the playoffs, because I think this younger kid have better legs.
Mm.
But, you know, I would take Patrick Mahomes just for the fact that Phillip Rivers hasn't shown me, and I'm going to your point, in the postseason that he can be that guy yet. When he gets to the postseason, hey, the lights ain't made for everybody in the postseason. And we've known he has played extremely well throughout his career. I love Phillip Rivers. Man, that dude is a country talking, gun-slinging, throwing that rock all over the place. I love him. But when he gets to the postseason, he doesn't play the exact same way. And, you know, I believe in Patrick Mahomes. I know down the stretch of the last several games, he's thrown some interceptions. That can happen sometimes when you're just a first-year player and your arm is you're throwing a little bit more than you had in the previous years. In college, season's over already. Well, he's getting to the heart of his season right now. I think he's that guy. I think he has fresh legs. He's going to throw that ball from any angle on the field, and he can throw it to anybody across the field. So I will go with the young fella, Patrick Mahomes.
I'd love Phillip Rivers. Obviously, I played against him when we were going against him in the AFC West. Phillip Rivers to me, and I said this yesterday, he is the best quarterback in NFL history that has never won a Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. Now, I know who I'm talking about. Marino, Boone.
All these guys know?
Can't go past Danny. It's my opinion. I can tell you that. I look at his numbers. First of all, they're right there with Marino. He throws less interceptions. That, touchdowns, everything.
It's easier to throw the ball.
I don't think it's a different league either, okay? It's Phillip is from that older league, too, where they can still hit you.
No.
What are you talking? Anyways, my point is, I think he's in that conversation. Let's just say that for the sake of conversation.
Okay, yeah, he's
in the conversation with Marino, Warren Moon.
With everybody Marino, he's in the conversation.
First ballot Hall of Famers. Yeah. Okay. Now, if we look at these guys, like, he's forever going to be tied to that class of Eli and Ben Roethlisberger. If you look at the defenses that those two have played for, Ben Roethlisberger has had 11 top 10 defenses throughout his career. He's got 2 Super Bowl rings. Eli Manning, he had Hall of Fame players. He had Justin Tuck. Well, I don't know if Justin Tuck's a Hall of Famer, but he was playing at an All-Pro level. Jake Strahan's an All-Pro Hall of Famer. OC, Manukanura, whatever his name, I can't pronounce his name. And I'm looking at Ben, and I'm looking at this guy, Phillip Rivers. If you look at the defenses that he's played with good players. But not on. I don't think on that level of first ballot type Hall of Fame type.
He has them now.
Players.
He has them now.
And now the team is doing really. And now the team is doing really well. Yeah. That's where I think Phillip doesn't get a fair shake. Now answering the question, going forward, who would I want this year? I got to stick with Kansas City for two reasons, because I got to go there on Thursday night, and I got to do the game when they're inducting to the Ring of Honor where they play each other. But I think I like Patrick Mahomes anyway. I think he's playing really, really well right now. Phillip is playing outstanding. They're both MVP caliber guys.
It's not a shot at Patrick Mahomes at all. What it is understanding Phillip Rivers' situation. Phillip Rivers' back is against the wall. I think that's one of the reasons why he played so well this week is because he tricked off that game last week, and he came into this week saying, I'm going to make sure I'm not remotely part of the problem, completes 28 to 29 passes. And I think Phillip Rivers knows that if he really wants to be a first ballot Hall of Famer, he's got to do something in the postseason. He needs to qualify for a Super Bowl. Because, again, Tony's the only person that thinks he's better than Dan Marino. And the only way that any rational person would think he's on the same level or even close to Dan Marino is if he won or appeared in a Super Bowl. I think Phillip Rivers' back is against the wall. I think when you add in, and I know this wasn't really part of the conversation, but Ingram and Bosa and what they're going to do defensively for the Chargers, the Chiefs don't have that on the other side. Now, I know they just lost Gordon, but I think, again, I just think that's going to bring out more from Phillip Rivers. I just like Phillip Rivers moving forward this year.
I just don't understand why would you have an argument that's based off, oh, Phillip Rivers is going to be motivated because he's never had success in those moments, but this is the year he's going to have it because his back's against the wall, versus a guy who hasn't been in that moment, so he has a blank canvas. And if anything, I would let my imagination say, this guy seems clutch, poised beyond his years, composed. Why not bet on him? And he's actually playing better if we're splitting hairs between the two. Like, this fully motivated Phillip Rivers is amazing. But guess what? Whatever you want to call the level of motivation of Patrick Mahomes is even more amazing. I don't like when we get into, well, the dynamics is going to make you better than this other
guy. Sometimes situation does make people better.
But we haven't seen that situation ever present itself and materialize for Phillip Rivers. He's had 15 chances. Patrick Mahomes, this is his second year. I will bet with that blank canvas.
Rod Woodson and Tony Gonzalez are back. Let's move to Indianapolis, where the Colts won their fifth straight, knocking off the Dolphins behind Andrew Luck's 343 yards and three touchdown passes. Meanwhile, in Carolina, Russell Wilson outshined Cam Newton with a game-winning drive to send the Panthers to their third straight loss. When you look at both Wilson and Luck's recent numbers, it's easy to see why both the Seahawks and Colts are in the playoff hunt. Since week six, Luck is 5-1 and Wilson is 4-2. Plus, both quarterbacks have been highly efficient with the ball, completing over 70% of their passes with an excellent quarterback rating as well. All right, the question here is, who's leading a more dangerous 6-5 team, Russell Wilson or Andrew Luck? This is very close. I watched both games yesterday very intently. I'm just going to go with Russell Wilson because I think their defense, their new revamped defense, I like a little bit better than the Colts defense. And I just something, Russell Wilson, I always underestimate him because I really don't like short quarterbacks. But every time I watch him, he makes these special, special plays. And so I guess I would lean Russell Wilson's Seahawks a bit more dangerous than the Colts.
And I would lean Andrew Luck and the Colts. And I'm fighting my own urges because sometimes I get sucked up into watching Russell Wilson make those extraordinary plays, and you're just like, it has to be them. But they don't have balance on offense. They draw it in the dirt in terms of their passing game. Their run game is number one in the league, but then in the passing game, it's like 26, bottom of the league. It takes those superhero efforts from Russell Wilson drawing it in the dirt for them to bail themselves out. So I'll go with the methodical team. I'll go with Andrew Luck and a guy who's been protected. What did they say, five straight games, no sacks until yesterday? Eight straight games with 300 yards and three touchdowns. Like, that's methodical. That's moving the chains. That's consistency. That strikes fear in a defender versus Russell Wilson. Okay, most times we're going to have success, but you just got to look out for the home run ball. So I'm going with the methodical team that it seems like their game plan is being better executed. It's the Colts.
If you're watching these two teams, the Seattle Seahawks has a better offense just for the fact they can run the football down the throat of any defense in the National Football League. I mean, Carson, Penny, and Davis, them guys run the ball down everybody's throat. along with Russell Wilson. Remember Russell Wilson, second round pick. Nobody thought he was going to be anything. Short little guy.
Fourth round pick.
A fourth round pick. And a baseball player. And this guy can play. I mean, this, and what I love about him is that he's probably done more pirouettes than any other quarterback in the history of football.
What I don't like.
That's what I don't like.
But he makes plays.
Right.
And to your point, Witt, listen, Kenny Norton Jr. up there, the D.C. in Seattle, he has made this defense a better defense than anybody thought they were going to be this year. The Legion of Boom is all done. Nobody's there anymore. These guys are playing fast and physical still. And when you look at them, they can run against anybody. When you can run the football, especially if you go into the postseason, you can beat anybody on the road or at home. I like to see that off.
Oh, sorry. Russell Wilson was a third rounder. And yeah. How old are you, Rod? Stop talking about the running game like that's going to get you to the promised land.
When you run the ball like they running it,
I was just about to tell you,
I think those days are over.
Yeah, brother.
Dinosaur days.
How do you keep good offenses off the field?
Yes, if you can run
the game. Say it one more time.
But here's the deal. When that offense does get on the field now, what's happening?
You didn't want to answer the question.
If you go against the Los Angeles Rams or the Saints in the playoffs, or you go against the Kansas City Chiefs.
How do you keep them on the sideline?
These suckers are going to come in when they get up. They're going to score. Now you have to score. And they're going to keep putting you in it because they're relentless because of the rules, too. We were having this discussion yesterday. You remember the defense, which I'm sure your defensive coach used to tell you this, impose your will on them. You're not imposing your will on anybody anymore on defense because you can't. Because your hands are handcuffed now. You can't hit me when I go over the middle.
Good defense.
You can't grab me. It's hard to do. I'm not afraid of you anymore. And these offenses, that's why numbers are up, you know, and it's working for the NFL. This is right where the NFL wants it. It's not going anywhere. That's where sustainable, that running, I think during the regular season, they're going to beat the okay, mediocre teams. But once you get to the playoffs, baby, you better, just like the Super Bowl last year, had pretty good defenses in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, top five.
Set the record for offense, because that's what's going to happen. I like the Colts. The Colts for sure. I think the Colts can put up points consistently. They can go out there and score you that 35 points. Because right now, how are you going to beat the Saints if you're the if Seattle?
Right.
If they're scoring 40 points a game right now.
No.
Russell Wilson, I need 40 points out of you. I don't think it's going to happen.
Well, first of all, Tony, you keep referencing the Saints, and we act like they don't have Alvin Kamara and Mark Ingram and aren't being driven by their running game. Mm-hmm. The Saints are being driven. The greatest offense, the best team in football right now, is being driven by its running game.
It's being led by its running game, but it's not the only thing that it has. Where when you look at Russell Wilson and their passing game, there is a disparity between their running game and their passing game, whereas there's more of an equality in the running game in New Orleans with the passing game of Drew Brees and his completion percentage. You're not getting the same thing out
of
that
passing game. You guys want to see the ball going on the field, not saying that. When you look at the Seattle Seahawks, we don't see it's a pass first. Since it's a run first, they're not as good. But when you watch them play, I'm telling you, and you watch them play against the Rams, which is one of the better teams, they was gashing these dudes, and they stay right in the game. Now, that's why I like this offense better than the Indianapolis Colts, because if the Indianapolis Colts came out here to play the Rams, they wouldn't gash them the same way. They would not.
And you take that Colts team outdoors in the playoff without that commitment to the running game that Seattle and them had.
I knew I liked you for a reason.
Right. You take them outdoors, you got to go to Pittsburgh or New England or anywhere, or Kansas City, anywhere outdoors without that reliable running game, there's a problem. Y'all just want to throw away the running game like it doesn't.
Throw it away. I'm just saying, especially the Colts, their offense is predicated around big old tight ends, okay? They're doing something that's unprecedented in NFL history. They're about to set the record for the most touchdowns scored ever by collectively for a tight end group. You saw it yesterday. I think they had another three touchdowns. That means they're not even going that far down the field. They got T.Y. Hilton for that. Yes, 3-yard pass. That's an extension of the running game. I like Andrew Luck.
I'm with you. I just had to do some quick homework here. Ahead. All right, so we look at Seattle's passing game, 26th in the league. So I said, I don't know. Let me just take a shot in the dark. What are the teams below them? And let's see if they strike any fear in terms of being an offensive team. Does Arizona strike any fear, anybody? This is by passing. Nope. And they're worse. They're right there. Buffalo, Jets, Tennessee.
Let me tell
Miami,
you what you're doing.
Dallas,
let
anybody. Me tell you. My point about? Is all What's the sorry point? Teams are bad in the pass offense. And this is another team
no,
like Tony
you
said.
Have no
they
point.
Will only be
you have no point.
Team.
Because we're talking about Seattle and we're talking about Russell Wilson. Yeah. We're not talking about Arizona's rookie quarterback. We're not talking about Buffalo's rookie quarterback.
So why is Seattle's pass offense ranked right by Buffalo, Tennessee?
Because they skin the cat a different way. They use the running
not
game.
Not
they
skin,
use
brother.
The running game to set up their passing game.
Rock, stop playing with this dude.
Let me tell you something, man. It would be
Witt,
like
I like it, Witt. It I like
be,
it, Witt.
You know, let me tell you what Marcellus would do. Let me tell you what Marcellus would do. If we were having a debate about Tupac and Biggie and who was the greatest rapper, Marcellus would go, well, Kenny Chesney sold more records.
Follow me here.
We're talking about Seattle. Why do I need to talk about Buffalo and Arizona?
Because they're grouped. They're all bunched. What's the bottom third
passing
teams?
We asked a question
teams?
With two offenses.
The bottom teams in passing offense, Seattle is right there with all those teams I mentioned. Any coincidence in all those teams in terms of
did you watch this Sunday's game when Russell Wilson threw for 330 yards?
Respect.
Yes.
Yes. Did you? He can do what needs to be done.
And would you say extraordinary efforts, look, superhero efforts, pirouettes? We always it's always the same stuff. It is not methodical, like you said. Line up, give it to my tight end, T.Y. Hilton, whoever it may be.
You can take that offense anywhere in football, anywhere they play football. You can take that offense. I'm sorry, this. Pass heavy offense, better off in a dome.
Okay, and you know what? In January, we're going to take them home because that's where they're going to be. That running game is not going to lead them to maybe one victory in the playoffs. Certainly not deep.
All right, welcome back to the show with Locke and Wiley. We're joined now by Fox Sports basketball analyst, but more importantly, Ohio State alum Jim Jackson.
Ah, man.
All right, Jim, let's move to your Buckeyes who blew out the Wolverines 62-39 on Saturday. It was the most points Ohio State ever scored in the rivalry. Urban Meyer's group has now won four straight after their ugly loss to Purdue. Meanwhile, Oklahoma won a shootout versus West Virginia. Since both the Sooners and the Buckeyes are 11-1, that's led to a lot of debate over which team belongs in the college football playoff. I may have a bias because I watch more Big Ten than Big 12.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I've been unimpressed with the Big Ten. And so I feel like Ohio State exposed Michigan is overvalued. And I think Ohio State a bit overvalued. And again, it may be because I just haven't watched the Big 12 as closely this year because I know the Big 12 hasn't been great. But I would rather see Oklahoma and that offense, the number one offense in the country, in the college football playoff. Over Ohio State.
You know, if Oklahoma's offense comes, that defense got to come too.
Whitlock. Exactly.
Whitlock, no, sir. I guess I watch a healthier portion of Big 12. This is an Oklahoma team, horrible defense. I mean, not just in the points they put up, but you could just watch it by lineup, by assignment, by discipline. Just bad, wide open touchdowns. Watching them go against West Virginia, I'm like, is Randy Moss somewhere, like, trying to go back and play? This is insane. I'm watching this. And it's not great football. It's just great offensive production. I want to see Ohio State in the college football playoffs for many reasons. One, they've beaten more top 25 teams. 4-0 against those teams versus Oklahoma, just 1-0. So, that's not enough. I see the body of work for Ohio State. Two, let's respect what Ohio State is doing. They've rallied. Like, you talk about a loss and then galvanizing themselves and rallying. And in a game where most people were saying they're going to lose this game and probably it's going to be the worst game they lose this year because of Michigan and that defense, they go out there and give them a six-deuce Impala. They 62 on Michigan's defense? Are you kidding me? So for all those reasons, let's not even talk the economics. And, if there's a tie, everyone wants Ohio State in the college football playoffs. It's even.
Well, you know I do because, of course, I went to Ohio State.
There it is.
But the optics don't look good when you lose to an unranked Purdue team. 49-20. Okay, and like you said, Ohio State four top 20 wins with a chance against Northwestern to get one more.
All right.
Okay, but the loss for Oklahoma to Texas was on a neutral site.
Three-point
okay,
game.
So when the optics don't look good when you put it in that aspect, but when you look at it, if you're watching that Michigan game, you say, you know what, Ohio State's defense gotten a little bit better, even though they've been much maligned throughout the course of the year, just like Oklahoma's. But the way it sits right now, the AP poll has Oklahoma 5, coaches poll Oklahoma 5. Mm. Power rankings may have it flip-flop,
But unless Oklahoma loses that game against Texas, I don't see how Ohio State leapfrogs
them. Oh, that's going to be the team. One, look, I'd rather play Northwestern and dictate my fate than have to go against a team I already lost to. But for me, I think that the way that they leapfrog them, obviously, is a simple way of just winning their game and
Does Texas. Does that have to be a blowout? What if Oklahoma just barely beats Texas and Ohio State just routes Northwestern?
It's rooting interest for Ohio State. Let's just be real. Like, right. You know, this is all big business still. Right. In that college football playoff committee room, when they close the door, when the cameras are off, they're like, is there any way we get Ohio State in this conversation? Think about your eye roll. This is something that they talk about in boxing. How do you grade, how do you judge a boxing match? Which dude would you rather be? You want to, you know, just don't even get caught up in how many punches and stuff. Who would you rather be? I do not want to watch Alabama go against Oklahoma.
Why not?
99-23. Like, what would that score be? It would be insane. I do not want to see that. The eye roll would be way stronger. I want to see Ohio State give them a reasonable
match. Why wouldn't it be a 55-51 game?
Because Alabama's defense is not giving up 51. Stop it. You already know that. That's my point. So Ohio State gives me the swing for the fences that I want to see in that 1-4 matchup.
We've seen Purdue curb stomp Ohio State.
We've seen Maryland. Maryland put up 51 points.
51.
And that's the problem because I know that Urban is going to prepare his team, and we've seen it against Michigan, but then does it go back to this? Michigan, number one rated pass defense. Fine. But in the Big Ten, who else is prolific in scoring like that? So I don't know how relevant that really is to the conversation in regards to Ohio State. The game plan was great, especially on the defensive end from Urban Meyer and the defensive coordinator. Don't get me wrong. And I love to see from the optics Ohio State because we travel.
Yes.
Oh, we travel. When it come down to it,
yes,
we sell out and we take over. But I just don't see it happening just like last year when they lost to Iowa. Okay, when they shouldn't have lost. I don't see how it happens unless Oklahoma, which could, because Texas, neutral side again, takes that out.
Look at you trying to prepare yourself. You know you're rooting against everything you said.
You know I am, but I'm being realistic.
Yeah.
All right, let's move to San Antonio and the NBA, where the Spurs are off to their worst start in 15 years. A lot of people are saying that's because they traded Kawhi Leonard to Toronto in the offseason. Saturday, Coach Greg Popovich fired back. He said Kawhi was a great player, but not a leader. Here's what Kawhi had to say about that.
I heard about it, but, you know, it's just funny to me because, you know, I don't know if he's talking about last year or not, but I guess when you stop playing, I forget how you lead. But other than that, I mean, it doesn't matter. I'm here with the Raptors, and I'm focused on the season and not what's going on the other side.
Nah, sir. If that doesn't sound like a great leader, I don't know what does.
Well, I'm not talking to you right now. That's messed up.
He didn't buy into it?
If that doesn't, I mean, he sounded like a great leader to me. I'm going to run through a wall for him. Look, Greg Popovich is a bully and a hater.
Mm.
And he's playing in a league that's really soft, and he's frustrated. His way of bullying players and all that stuff is going out the window, and the whole league caters to players and treats them like, you know, they're so precious and sensitive. And so he took a little shot here at Kawhi. It's the wrong. Pop's time has passed. He's reached his expiration date. It's a bad look, in my opinion. He sounds bitter.
It's a horrible look. Another pop shot, as I call it. You know, he stays salty of late, especially with this Kawhi thing. It really is because he spent so much time and energy, and look, with amazing results, building that culture. And how dare you, Kawhi Leonard? I thought you were the next one in line to carry this torch. Kawhi's going somewhere to light it. And now Popovich is like mind blown. No one wants to be a Spur anymore. Now they're playing non-playoff basketball in San Antonio right now. Hey, he's been a 21 straight playoff appearances. That may be broken this year. And you're still taking shots at a guy who's not going to suit up for your team. Look, I don't know who they employed with this initiative. And it started with Popovich. It went to Manu Ginobili, Tony Parker, Bruce Bowen. He even lost his job doing it. Like, what the hell are y'all doing out there just shooting at Kawhi Leonard? It's a horrible look. They need to move past it.
Well, here's the thing about it. Pop wasn't asked a question about Kawhi. It was a follow-up question about leadership to Patty Mills. And then he kind of threw that in there. You got to keep in mind, this San Antonio Spurs team built their organization through drafts and free agency, but not big-time free agents at the time. So they've always had somebody in line. Their roster really is not that good, okay? When you drafted Kawhi, you knew he wasn't a vocal person. You knew he wasn't going to be a vocal leader. So why even come out and throw about the thing that really pisses me off is that when Kawhi was there, they loved Kawhi because, one, he didn't get caught up into the Hollywood stuff. He was quiet. He was professional. He went about his business. It was the San Antonio way. But now when Kawhi was trying to look out for himself, all those same attributes that they said about him, now they looked at it like, well, we could never understand him. We couldn't read him. He wasn't vocal. I'm like, come on, man.
Yeah, that means they took it for granted. It's just as simple as that. They took it for granted. They mailed it in that Kawhi was going to be a Spur. Why? Because he's quiet. Hey, Tim Duncan was quiet. Guess what? He's going to be like our next to him Duncan, 2.0. It's not that simple, man. And like you said, it's a horrible look when you prop someone up for all the same reasons that you're now trying to tear them down for.
Well, look, I'm going to defend Pop, because I don't want to act like I haven't been there in terms of, you know, you develop and invest in someone, show them. They didn't even know what Louboutin shoes were before they met
you.
Preach.
He's a red.
Never carried a Louboutin shoe. Never carried a designer handbag in their life. And then they run off someplace else. I put you in that position.
No, you didn't do jack. You just dressed up what I was.
Yeah.
So I get where Pop is coming from. Yeah. Again, if he doesn't play for Pop, they traded for him, I think, for George Hill or something with the Pacers early on. They went out and got him, built him into this great player, and when it was his time to take over, he says he didn't want it. I would be a little bit bitter. I would hold my powder, though.
I don't want to pile on, Pop, but this is a felony. This is not a misdemeanor. Like, seriously, they had the Admiral talking bad about Kawhi last
Everybody
year.
Was. I mean, Everybody
I
was. Everybody was.
I mean, it was like all guns blaze on Kawhi. And this was literally bullying, because this was a guy who was not fighting back. He was quiet. He just went about his business. He protected his body.
He went about laying down all last year.
Well, that's because they misdiagnosed him. But who's going to have the last laugh?
Thank you.
Kawhi's going to have the last laugh.
You don't want to play through a misdiagnosed injury, and then I put that on film, and then you now pay me according to that.
You're not healthy. You're not playing the way you were.
Especially this organization.
He had never eaten at a 5-star restaurant before Pop.
Good for him. That's good for him.
Time to get antisocial.
Oh,
man, it's my favorite segment. And our social media manager, Darnell Smith, is here to tell us what's popping on those Twitter streets.
Right.
Beyond our Warren Central Warriors. We'll get into that in a minute. But Darnell, what's cracking?
First of all, Marcellus, I see you got your book right here, Never Shut Up. When you gonna give me my free copy?
Your free copy?
I've been here for a while now.
And once that sentence doesn't have free in it, I got you, baby. I can't hook up all my friends. I ain't gonna sell no books.
I feel you. I respect that. All right, though. Let's start with the Browns and Bengals game from yesterday, where Baker Mayfield led the Browns to a 35-20 victory. After the game, his former head coach, now an assistant with the Bengals, Hugh Jackson, tried to show the young QB some support. And it turned to a very awkward exchange. Baker clearly blows off the hug and settles for a quick handshake. Guys, does Baker look pretty petty here?
Petty's not the word I'm going to use. Okay. He looks pretty authentic. He looks pretty like, you know what, Hugh? I've seen you say a bunch of supportive things in public about me, but the real is you weren't supportive. I'm the number one pick in the draft, and you insisted on Tyrod Taylor being the starting quarterback here. I think that Baker, and again, we didn't even get into this. Did you see the defensive back that handed Hugh the ball after the interception?
Rolling.
To me, the whole vibe from Baker to the DB disrespecting him, like, there was no love for Hugh in that Cleveland locker room.
At all, man. Baker Mayfield with the elbow lock. How gangster is that when somebody comes in for the bro hug and you give him the elbow lock? James Harden called me like that one time when I was at Top Golf. And I was like, James, I thought we were cool.
Right.
Got the elbow lock. I was like, I must have said something about you, boy. Which one of them dudes from South Central? Because, I mean, Baker Mayfield acting real gangster on that one. That's your red bottom friend when she see you again and you come out. Watch you all that. Watch that elbow get locked on you, boy. Nothing worse than that.
I have experienced that. Darnell, what's next?
Yeah, moving on to another rookie quarterback, Lamar Jackson, who just won the second straight start for the Ravens. Many people have been debating if Lamar is even good enough to be an NFL quarterback, but Twitter has been showing its support for the young QB. Even Saints running back Alvin Kamara chimed in after the Ravens win, tweeting, quote, yes, sir, and tagging Lamar. Guys, even if Flacco was ready to go this week against the Falcons, do you think the Ravens should stick with Lamar as their starter?
I watched all of this game, and Lamar threw two interceptions, and he pushed the ball downfield rather than throw the ball downfield most of the day. They ran him less. It was a completely, particularly in the first half, they stayed away from running him. In the second half, they did run the football with Lamar, and it worked out. Look, I think I'm not going to read anything into yesterday. It's not proof of anything other than the Raiders are really, really bad. I'm going to hold judgment on Lamar until I see some more information.
I think it's proof that he's not ready at the quarterback position, but they keep winning games. So while he is trying to learn that position, if we continue to put up W's, we will keep you as our starter. What I've seen from him is a guy who's still in his own head, like you said, pushing the ball, aiming the ball, not trusting that he has the ability, because when you're a young talent like that and you're playing quarterback, every day someone is pulling you with some new wisdom, pushing you with this new direction. And he's just right now, you can just see it's a frantic mindset of like, which way is up? Which way should I go with this play? He's not relaxed except when he's running the ball. So I would just go with the W's until he finally gets exposed.
Yeah, I think there are some people I saw that For the Win tweeted out, the Ravens can't possibly go back to Joe Flacco after the boost Lamar Jackson has provided. I just haven't seen that. If you actually watch the game, you saw a couple of bad interceptions.
Special teams touchdown. You saw a defensive touchdown. Like T. Suggs, like, that wasn't offense.
What you saw was more of Black Tim Tebow and the victory without a lot of real true quarterback.
You don't think just saying Tim Tebow is enough?
The Black Tim Tebow is what Lamar is.
I kind of get that part.
Is,
but, a little right. redundant.
All right. A little bit. We know he's black.
His name Lamar. Ain't no doubt.
All right, man.
All right, Donnell, what's next?
All right, moving on to my favorite story of the weekend.
Yes.
We're like an hour on hand to see how once the Warriors win their ninth state title after defeating Carmel on Friday, 27-7.
David Bell,
yes,
best
sir.
Receiver in the country.
Yes, ooh, he,
nice.
Yes, he is.
Nice.
The Warriors
nice.
Made history this season.
Nottingham Village undefeated. Legends.
14-0 record.
All right.
Possibly the greatest football team to ever come out of Warren Central. So, ooh. Whitlock, was this your best Thanksgiving weekend of all time?
It rates up there, and I do believe it. And I told the kids this before the game, or no, it was after the game. They interviewed me. I told them that this is the greatest Warren Central team ever, and we've had some great ones. But what they overcame, David Bell, our receiver, was injured going into this game. Jaden George, Jeff George's son, became the third George to lead our team to a state title. Mm-hmm. Both of Jeff George's sons have led Warren Central High School to state titles. His father, Jeff, Jeff led us to two.
Hold on, Jeff George's kids go there?
Come on, now.
Jeff George didn't make no money in the league. He's still living in the hood.
No.
My kids ain't going to my high school. I tell you that.
Let me tell you this.
What? That's all
it's
I got.
It's a powerhouse school with a great educational system. Jeff George sends his kids to our high school.
They don't live out here.
I can tell by the uniforms. Y'all doing something right.
He sends his kids. Oh. Trust me, they were wearing my cleats, by the way, on Friday night.
That didn't help them.
Yeah, they did.
Can I see that picture one more time, man? Because I've noticed another thing, man. I ain't take shots at y'all.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Was anybody at the game? Because, I mean, I'm just
Dude,
looking
that's
at
after the game and we celebrate. And we in the,
you usually got that front row of somebody on autograph.
We in Lucas Oil Stadium, man. We in a NFL
You're
stadium.
You're the biggest hater.
I am a hater, even on the high school level. But respect and congrats,
Romeo Elliott, congratulations. Willie Eaton. Jason West, our head coach. Coach Jacobs, love all y'all.
What, the
all
black
y'all.
Bill Belichick's?
Shout out to my cousin Marcus Houston, man. JV guy, but he getting his ring.
Thank you.
Respect. Right.
Darnell, what's next?
Let's talk about Jalen Ramsey. During the offseason, the all-pro defensive back took a couple jabs at Bills rookie quarterback Josh Allen, calling him trash. He said the Bills made a stupid draft pick. Ramsey also tweeted a picture in May of Allen at Bills practice and captioned it, "That's a pick waiting to happen." Well, yesterday, Allen had the last laugh as the Bills beat the Jags 24-21. Y'all think Ramsey's 15 minutes of fame are up?
I hope.
Wow.
I hope.
15?
I really hope they are.
He had two picks last week.
He needs to stop it. He gave Buffalo an emotional advantage and a reason to show up and play.
Good point.
He talked Leonard Fournette into going – in my opinion, he set the atmosphere for Leonard Fournette to go crazy and get tossed out of the game. Jalen Ramsey cost him this game.
Good points, good points. You don't want to believe in bulletin board material, but, hey, something had to give him the ammunition for Buffalo to go out there and beat down Jacksonville like that. And Josh Allen had a good game running it and even some of the throws. So, respect to the Bills. Go Mafia.
Last but not least, Darnell.
Yes, sir. So, watch the first thing first this morning.
Right.
Chris Carter was talking about Michigan football and had an interesting point on Jim Harbaugh. Take a listen.
Y'all tell me one thing. I'm open to it. I'm open to innovative new things. Tell me one thing that Harbaugh has done. Tell me one quarterback that he's developed. Tell me one offensive player at Michigan that's been outstanding in 4 years. Tell me.
Does he have a point here?
Caron Higdon, maybe the running back.
I'm over here Googling it. Googling like, boy, stop.
They got a receiver that's pretty good. Shante Peoples or whatever. I think, you know, Ohio State fans can certainly gloat today and this weekend. And, you know, Jim Harbaugh still has some meat left on the bones. He got some work to do.
Yeah, he got some work to do. I mean, this one was hand-delivered to him in terms of opportunity. With that defense, with the way that they were rolling this year after the week one loss to Notre Dame, you just was like, and college football playoffs on the line. And you not only get beat down, and all your hopes are gone. That year is over, man.
Jim Harbaugh's legacy as a head football coach may come down to I developed Colin Kaepernick. That might be his legacy.
Oh, the GOAT. Yeah. The GOAT. Selling more jerseys than when he played.
All right, thank you, Darnell. Uncle Jimmy's here to help us talk about our approval rating for Aaron Rodgers. I hope you had a great Thanksgiving.
He guilty.
You're a judge now, huh? You're a judge.
Well, right about now, this is what I'm doing. I'm providing some family service. For family advocate for this time of year. As we know, all along throughout the inner city, in the homes and in the kitchens, there's arguments going on right now about who's gonna take the chitlins and who's gonna take the hog balls. You understand? Who's gonna take the greens? Who's gonna take the collards? You understand what I'm saying?
So right. This is family court?
Yeah, this is family court.
And you judge.
Why ain't nobody taking my food? Judge, you got cats all over the counter, that's why.
All right, well, let's move on. Let's look at a highlight from our discussion earlier about Aaron Rodgers.
If anybody's going to turn this around, it's this man. I would not be surprised. Are you going to be surprised when they rattle off five in a row, if they do?
It's not going to happen. I think the wear and tear on his body is starting to catch up with him. Last year, he couldn't overcome them and their bad start. They fell short of the playoffs. It's going to happen again this year.
I'm with Tony on that one. Backs against the wall. With Aaron Rodgers being that talented at that position that has so much control and dictates terms for a football squad, you got to bet with this team. You got to bet that this team can try and figure this out in this moment.
All right, Uncle Jimmy, that was our conversation about Aaron Rodgers.
Judge Jimmy.
What's your take?
Go ahead. First of all, let me tell you something. How dare you? How dare you attack Aaron Rodgers?
Get him.
How dare you?
Get him, Judge.
How dare you drag his family into this?
Ooh.
Furthermore, how dare you drag the name and reputation of Wilt Chamberlain into this?
Oh, yeah, you did go there.
I'm here to tell you that's what you did.
Yep.
If I'm not mistaken, I could be wrong, but I heard you earlier. Now, tell me if I'm wrong. Did you say that Aaron Rodgers wasn't fit mentally or physically?
I did say that.
I'm just asking that, nephew, because I'm here to tell you. When was the last time you looked in the mirror?
Get him,
Judge. It ain't pretty.
Throw the book at him, Judge.
They told me, I'm your family. I'm going to tell you, you just as round as you is brown, okay? So you need to cut that out.
I got a joke, Jimmy.
What's the joke?
You Judge Jimmy and he Judge Ito. Like, eat.
How he eat.
Oh,
I get it. And on that note.
Thank you very much.
On that note, what?
Aaron Rodgers' brother. Boy, he need his ass beat. He need that ass beat.
Wick.
I need to whoop knots across his head as quick as he can rub them. You understand what I'm saying? Because for real, man, real talk, family, we don't do that.
We don't.
We don't put business out there like that. Am I right or wrong?
There it is.
You're right.
Huh? You're
right.
Man, I told y'all on this show last week, what did I tell y'all? I said, hey, man, I've been married 5 times. Mm-hmm. Ain't no big deal. I'm telling you about mine.
Hey, I got 15 step kids. You understand what I'm saying?
15 step kids.
Give, take one. I don't know. I got 15 step kids. Let me tell you something about all my 15 step kids.
What?
I bet you can't pay now one of them to say nothing negative about Dante. I bet you can't say nothing about Dante.
We out of time. We gotta get to our approval ratings. Who the hell is Dante?
But yeah, anyway, who is Dante?
We gotta move. Aaron Rodgers, my approval rating for Aaron Rodgers has dropped to a 73. Not as 6 points down from my previous rating.
Only thing I could say is the job performance obviously is taking a hit. That was a pedestrian effort last night. The rest, the all-time status, same dude. Matter of fact, character went up. He hadn't even responded to his brother. He's like, man, get out of my life. Stop trolling.
Respect. You just jealous of the Big Dipper. That's what's wrong with you. You're jealous of the Big Dipper, and I leave it at that.